What's going on, guys? Welcome to the Namra podcast. I'm Justin, and I'm here joined with Ashley, Taylor, and Sahil. And this week, we wanted to bring you a couple awesome bits. First, we're going to talk a little bit about how to properly evaluate yourself on social media and some of the other trends and tips that we think would be helpful for you guys to know, as well as some tools of the trades. And also, we have some different review material that we want to go over. Let's kick it off. So how's everybody's week been? Give me a rundown of what everybody's working on. What's new?
It's been good. I haven't been doing the podcast for a couple of weeks, so it's nice to be back with the team. So yeah, it's good. I'm excited. Same old stuff, just grinding along. How about you guys? Anything new? Anything big going on this week?
I mean, no day's ever the same in, you know, kind of like what we do at least. But this week it's been a lot about just learning about new ads, updates and stuff like that. I mean, Facebook and Google are notorious for releasing their mid-year major updates kind of end of July, early August. So we're seeing a lot of that happening. So that's really what this week's been going into, just seeing what they're going to add, what they're going to remove, making the proper changes, things like that.
Yeah, so you were telling me recently, or I think it was last night, you were saying that, look out, there's going to be a lot of stuff changing, because once they start changing on the ad side of things, you start seeing it on the other side as well, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, and this year around, it's significant changes too. I mean, sometimes it's usually like one big one and then like smaller bug fixes here and there, but there's like so much happening right now on both of those platforms that I'm just curious to see, you know, what's going to be released after like the betas stages and stuff is complete, and also what's removed. Right. Right. Like what I've noticed, at least from like the last year or two, is like they've been focusing more on removing things rather than adding. Like a lot of, you know, just as a quick example, like on Meta ads, like removing certain audiences, removing certain, you know, targeting functions, things like that. So, yeah, a lot is happening. And we're just trying to monitor that and stay updated on it.
Why do you think that is, that they're starting to remove more features rather than adding them on? Because I feel like a lot of the time they were notorious for adding and adding and adding and trying. So from your perspective, what's that reason?
I mean, a lot has just happened in the last, you know, few years or so, like the whole, you know, attack on privacy, you know, asking apps not to track. There's just, you know, Meta has been through lots of Congress hearings on what they've been up to. So yeah, you know, a lot is just going on. Technologies are improving. The way people go day to day throughout life is changing, right? So they're just trying to factor kind of all of that in, at least what, you know, that's what I think. And another thing that I also have been seeing is like they are trying to really simplify some of their tools. Like before, when they kept just adding functions, like things were changing. Like someone would be trying to learn Ads Manager, for example, right? And then it would look completely different in a couple of days, and some of the buttons wouldn't work. Like they were just overcomplicating it for themselves, really. Like their approval processes were getting backlogged and everything. So I think they are trying to simplify it as well. I don't think they're doing a good job of that, because as these things evolve, they obviously have to make things more advanced. So, but yeah, I mean, I think that was their goal after it anyways, but yeah, we'll see what these next round of updates hold.
Ashley, have you seen a lot of, like, what have you seen as far as the biggest change? Because you're in there on Facebook Manager more than anyone. So what's the biggest thing that you've seen change recently?
Yeah, I was going to echo Sahil and say this past week I've been working on a lot of creative projects with new clients and some revamps and things like that, but also Meta specifically going through changes, which lately has been more like glitches and things like that. And I oversee someone who I'm teaching how to publish things and schedule things and use the tools. And as we're going through some of these glitches and things changing, I'm having to kind of go along for that ride and say, okay, well, here's what we're going to do. Here's what's happening today. Here's what, I guess, change today. So yeah, kind of just having to adapt very quickly and just go along with it has kind of,
yeah, be able to learn on the fly.
Exactly,
I know.
Yeah.
I've said it so many times to clients when I'm like, even just trying to like add myself as a manager, add ourselves to the business account or whatever it might be. Like, I swear to God, the button was here yesterday, like last week. Yeah. This is
how
you did it.
I know what I'm doing.
And that's par for the course, because Meta, Facebook, whatever you want to call them, is always running different versions of the app. So depending on whose phone you're using, whose laptop you're using, you can experience a totally different user experience.
Exactly, yeah. There was a time last week where even just like the scheduling feature just wasn't putting out what I scheduled. I was like, you know what, I'm going to just ride along with it. I put a reminder on my phone, just post this manually today. It'll work in like 3 days probably.
Yeah.
So. Yeah, I mean, even Creator Studio had so many changes, right? At first it was all integrated through Business Manager. Then it became a separate tool called Creator Studio. And then it just became everything got... you know, mixed in again and called Meta Business Suite. It's like, there's lots of changes.
There's so many redundancies, which actually kind of makes sense that they're doing like a good consolidation, because it's like, I like the experience on Creator Studio. I always did. But now there's, if you're looking for certain analytics or insights, you can't get them on Creator Studio. You have to go back to Meta or Business or whatever it is. So there's a lot of redundancies. So it kind of makes sense that they're trying to consolidate a little bit, but I hope they're not consolidating the wrong things.
Yeah, I can agree with that. Because when I would be scheduling videos and organic posts, and there would be Creator Studio and then Business Suite, and I'm like, okay, I wonder why there's two separate things, because it was confusing when I was first learning.
And it's causing delays too, right? Because as they make these changes, it's like, you know, there's certain pages where we will try to go into the insights, but they just won't appear because it's just delayed. Like it hasn't carried over yet. And then there's, you know, other pages that even haven't even seen the new functions because they're just slowly being rolled out. So yeah, there's sometimes it becomes a mess, you know. I think we see it more because we're just doing this 24/7. Like it just feels more natural, this button's gone,
we'll just keep going.
Yeah, there's another way to do it.
Yeah, exactly.
The way you guys talk about it, I'm interested to see if this is going to be like the Wild West of social media and posting and like self-branding, because someday like we're not going to have glitches like this and instant updates. Like,
yeah,
it's crazy to think about someday.
Or I usually hear as technology advances, it gets harder to work. So is there going to be more glitches? But maybe it'll be less noticeable on our end, maybe.
So that's the weird thing, where it's like, from what I've seen, Google in particular, they've recently done something where they got rid of Google Business Profile, the app itself. So it used to be called Google My Business, that map, the app, the mobile app. And it worked pretty well. But now
it's
fucking overnight. It's like this app no longer exists. So it's like, oh my God. Now you have to do everything through, they're trying to consolidate that all through Maps or just Google Search. So we'll see how that plays out. But it's been kind of a pain because you can't verify a listing in a lot of ways through your phone now. So you have to do everything on a desktop for at least a couple of weeks. And then same thing, like you said, they're trying to make the experience easier. I know YouTube is playing around with now like automated video ads and video edit. They have like a system out there to make like generic videos for you. So
yeah, for like shorts and stuff.
For short, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So we'll see how that goes. Facebook did something similar a couple years ago when they basically had like, here are some automated graphic posts that we can make or animations. And people were a little bit like nervous because they were like, oh shit, they're coming for our job here.
Right.
But it's like, they were not very good.
No.
So it'll take time.
I see a bunch of TikToks of people making AIs to like create something, whether it's like an image, like they, you know, you type in like Lance Armstrong and a rubber ducky and it like creates 10 million of these images and stuff. It's fucking crazy what AI can do. And so recently somebody made an AI that creates music. So this kid played the AI like 1,000 hours of hip hop and it created its own hip hop song, and that shit banged.
It was good.
It was really good.
That's
crazy.
That app you're talking about, the art one, I know it's like you can do like make a picture of like a Coca-Cola can on top of a monkey's head and do it in like the style of like Salvador Dali. And it's like, Jesus Christ.
Yeah, kind of going back to, you know, your point about also like, is it going to get easier or, you know, pretty much more difficult, Justin? It's like another example is like with these changes, Google is getting rid of AdWords Express, which was their smart form of campaign. So which, you know, was pretty much designed for business owners that don't have the advanced knowledge of like, you know, Google Analytics and Google AdWords campaigns. Like, What Smart Campaigns enabled them to do is with, you know, like a few clicks of a button, kind of just, you know, simplified demographics and targeting, they were able to run campaigns. And, I mean, it's obviously going to be more difficult for those people, right? Because now only the advanced form remains.
And there were like whole agencies built on smart campaigns. They would never say that, but basically it was they were the low cost provider of Google Ads. So if you go somewhere and that cost, you know, we'll do your ads for very inexpensive. Those were all smart ad campaigns. So I don't know what those companies are going to do now because
suffer.
Yeah, you're forced to learn. You're forced to learn either the advanced ones or they're going to just stop operating. All right. Because, and, you know, these tools are, with these updates, even though like certain functions are going away, certain ones are being added, it's, they are getting more and more advanced. It's definitely like, you know, there's like, even for agencies like us, like we have to stay on top of that and make sure we're learning about the changes, like what we have to do differently and making sure the, you know, the campaigns are going to be, you know, at the same level of effectiveness that they used to be on. Like there is a lot happening.
Yeah.
Right. So if you don't stay on top of that, and especially for someone new,
it's
going to be very, very different.
I think that's a great point because I feel like I've seen a lot of creators who have expressed being unhappy about a lot of the changes, which makes sense. But especially an agency like us, it's our job to use those tools. So it's like we kind of don't really have a choice but to continue to learn how to just go along with it.
Yeah. Right. We're in the business of just like tough shit, deal with it.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. That's like our job.
Yeah. Bugs are always going to be like a, you know, those are going to be omnipresent. Like there's like, as they grow, change, like, you know, as they move things around, there will always be issues. I just, you know, I just wish that they would just have like support teams dedicated to like resolving bugs and stuff, because a lot of it now is just through a computer. Like, unless you reach out to Facebook support directly, whether that's a ticket or something, most of your reviews are just read by, you know, just computers. So like they don't have that human touch to it where like you might explain a situation and why you think it doesn't go against guidelines. They'll just automatically think, nope, flagged. Right. Like, and it has nothing to do with what they're even flagging, because it's like they just haven't developed these tools to the point where they can just let them run up, you know, on their own.
Yeah.
And that's with everything. Like even Meta has these like experts now that you can like schedule a call with and stuff. And, you know, I've had feedback from a few clients where they've done that just to see how it's like. And most of these people are just untrained and they don't even know what they're talking about. And it's like, they call at odd hours and it's like, so no one knows like what's going on with these updates. And there's just so much happening.
There's a lot of like hidden consequences. So like when you see Google or these platforms making large changes, people forget that they're just companies. And like, while they might have what seems like unlimited resources and dollars, they might have unlimited money, but they don't have unlimited human capital or resources. So when they invest 20% more effort and human capital into fixing up Ads Manager, there's hidden consequences. Like, for example, I'm willing to bet the reason why there's another trend going on right now that's people's Google reviews are not going up. Like, it's just something that's been really weird.
That is a real bug right now. Yep.
So I've gotten a few clients who've asked me about that. It happened to you personally. It's happened to me personally. And they're just kind of in a holding pattern and they're caught in limbo somewhere. And Google's not very transparent as far as like what's happening with those, but I would wager that it's an issue of human capital. There's just not enough focus on it right now. So there's just too many tickets to get to. I don't know if you have any insight on that.
I mean, I supported a support ticket about that just to, you know, talk to someone. And I did receive, you know, a call from someone on their team out in California. And I think they're just telling everyone the same thing. They're just like, oh, well, the review might have, you know, went against guidelines, or it might have done this or that. Like, I think it's the same, just, you know, printed out script that they're reading to everyone. But like, personally, we don't know if they have those reviews saved on their server somewhere, if those are just going to be lost once they fix this issue. Like, we don't know. They might not even know. But it definitely comes down to human capital, because I do think they're backlogged. Like, in terms of, you know, reviewing, you know, flagged reviews, in terms of just getting back to, you know, certain support questions, like, they're much slower than they used to be. And I don't think it's because there's a talent shortage and they can't find people. I think it's just due to there's just so much going on that they just, like, you know, they're trying to work on all of these different things. I mean, you have these smaller bugs that Meta has, but at the same time, they're trying to make big changes, like, you know, getting you to boost Reels even. That change is coming, where Yeah, you're going to be able to boost reels.
So
so it's like there's big changes, and then they're just not focused on these little ones. I mean,
and we've kind of all been hitting around like different trends and things. I think all this information that we just deal with on a day-to-day basis is good to get out there. But say, aside from tuning into the Namra podcast every week, what's a good way for people to stay up on this? I would say like being consistent and just continuing to like do it yourself. That's one way to experiment, be hands-on. But is there another way where people can, you know, keep up with trends? What's the best way to stay current on this stuff?
Yeah, I think if you're managing like your own social media, right? I think like let's say you just hit like a busy week or something where you haven't been able to actually just go through the cycle of getting your content, even just doing like a quick check-in of, you know, that can go a long way, because most of the times when these changes are happening, the platforms do notify you. Like they say like, hey, your view is going to be switching from this view to the new view,
read
like
the messages
this date
from
or
the,
something.
Yeah.
You
people
know,
skip through that all the time.
Yeah, because most of the time it is with those pop-ups that they guide you through some of the changes. So at least just in terms of knowing where the common buttons and common features that you were using are going to be moving towards, or if they're going to be, you know, eliminated, that might help. So if you are just, you know, hitting a busy period, just even doing like a quick 2-minute check-in, just make sure. I mean, that goes a long way. But other than that, staying on top of things, it's
a day-by-day process.
Day-by-day.
Did you have something you wanted to add to that?
Yeah, I think like just being generally aware of what's going on, it can be easy enough, especially if you're on the app. But I think something that can be helpful is not to get so overloaded with all the changes, because that's happened to me personally, where I'll be on like my Explore page and I'll see all the content that is doing very well, and I'll see it all at once, like a million posts in my mind, and then I'll have to kind of figure out, okay, I don't need to make this many reels or something like that at once. So I think just trying to take information in like a healthy and productive way is good when all these changes are happening and all these creators are on the platform. And obviously following people who are like in your niche and relate to what you're doing can help.
Yeah, don't overload yourself. Yeah. Take it one thing at a time.
Mm-hmm. You know, I've definitely made that mistake, and I've... Yeah, it can be overwhelming.
Yeah, and don't hesitate to ask questions. You know, it's completely okay. Mm-hmm. Like things change. We're always a resource. So if there is like questions as well, like we can, because like we're reading about this stuff every day. We're going through the cycles every day. So like, you know, we're more than happy to communicate any updates or changes that you might see.
Yeah, absolutely. From the creative side too, I mean, keeping up with like popular audios, like whether it's Facebook, Instagram, TikTok. TikTok's huge. Like if you choose one of the biggest, most popular songs right now, you're going to trend a lot quicker and a lot more likely to get more views than you were if you're not using an audio by the platform. So that's another way to
Do research, right? Do research, look at what the guys who are doing the best in the discovery section are doing. What are they using?
Yeah. And not only just audio too, but like topic points. So like if you're doing informational videos about XYZ, like look deeper into that, like what types of informational videos are doing the best and in your industry, and kind of like replicate those in your own creative spin.
Yeah. If you have someone who you really respect on there and you want to like kind of emulate their style, look at their last 10, 15 posts and see which one's doing the best.
And a lot of a lot of those guys are doing the same thing. I mean, whether it's like, you know, if you find one niche of 10 accounts and you have across 5 different niches, those 10 accounts in each different niche is going to be relatively almost the exact same.
Yeah.
The fonts, the styles, the editing,
the idea,
information, the ideas, all that. Yeah. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think going along that for creative people, on social media, like when you first start as a creative, you think that it's always posting like the finished product or what you just completed, but especially as an artist, learning that showing all the process is what people really like. And that's what helped build my following. People like seeing the process, and they like seeing me talk about what I'm doing instead of just like, here's a finished painting or here's my finished video. So definitely showing the process, because along with all the changes happening, people really like to see the creativity that leads up to the finished product.
Yeah, it's like documenting that. Like that's perfect. Documenting is another form of like storytelling. You're telling the story of how this came to be. It's like everyone loves the end product, but people are like, how the hell did you do that? That's kind of a little look behind the curtain, you know?
Yeah.
So,
and honestly, and now even with technology and Photoshop and Canva and all these tools that are so easy to use, it's like doing that storytelling in that way where you're documenting, it's almost beneficial to your career. That way you can kind of prove you're doing this, and people can have better conversations with you. And I think it's very useful.
Definitely. Yeah. I think when it comes to content, just never forget value, mm-hmm. right? As long as you're providing value in an authentic fashion, yep. you'll be okay in regards mm-hmm. to content.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, that's perfect.
Another thing that helps me stay in, you know, in the loop with upcoming changes is, and this is more so like on the ads end and functionality end, but you know, I like when a major change comes out, like I always have like a blank page where I'm testing some of these new functionalities with, and that's very easy to do. Like if you just create like a dummy page or something, like if you just log in one day and you're like, well, I used to post to IG like this, but now I don't know where the buttons are.
Yep.
Like if you have one like that, like at least you can just test around with the new buttons. Right. Because and that way you can learn it, you know, pretty fast.
Yep.
If you're like, well, Creator Studio used to look like this, like, let me just go to like, you know, like a blank page and just like mess around with the new functions and see where, you know, everything is. That might help you catch on with like the changes as well.
Yeah, that's a good idea. A dummy page is always good. Always have a burner account.
Yeah, I think things I used to do before I knew a lot of those tools is just to see how a picture will look on Instagram. I'll just post it very quickly, take a screenshot and delete it very fast. Yeah. Go to my camera roll, analyze it for a half hour.
Well, yeah. What I love to do is I usually will write out a post and do it how I want it to look, but then I'll save it as a draft. Mm-hmm. And then I'll have like
drafts.
10 different drafts that I can see as the grid form, like, you know, at least one line of what the grid will look like. That's helpful.
And now there's apps too where that you can just like connect your IG and it will like show it will like show you what like your feed would look like with like the post that you add, but it's
So now like that gives you the ability to get just more let you see and create it an entire page of like a collage or something like that.
Yeah, that's how people make like those posts with like a bigger painting that's like broken down into like different squares and stuff. Yeah. So it's like the whole there's like tons of apps that give you like feed previews now.
Yeah, mm-hmm. if there's anything that you want to do or you have a question, let's like put it into Google. Just type it out into Google and there's probably an article or a YouTube video on it or an app.
Probably millions.
Except on how to get Google reviews published, because apparently they don't.
It's like
the one un-Googleable thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And just so you know, and depending on the time when like people are listening, like if like expect a lot of changes to come, like late August, early September, maybe going even into the holiday season, but it's there is a lot of changes coming, especially particular to Meta and Google. Not so much LinkedIn, Twitter, and the others at the moment. I mean, Snapchat's kind of doing their own things. They're trying to add more personalization features and all. They're building out their ads campaign manager a little bit more, but more so with these two giants, there's just a lot happening. There will be bugs, like you might try to make a post, it's not going through, or you might open the app and it's just blank. You know, there's going to be a lot happening. So yeah, just don't freak out. Like they're just, you know, implementing changes. Like it's going to be fine.
Give it a day or two.
Yeah.
Give it a day or two. Try again.
Growing pains. That's what happens. So with trends too, I think another good topic to talk about would be followers. And I mean, obviously everybody starts at zero, but what are some good techniques or like mantras, I guess, to have about followers, like, you know, important details as far as like, you know, who should you try to be paying attention to? Who should you emulate? Where should you draw inspiration from? All that stuff. So anybody want to kick us off on that?
I think for me with followers is making sure that they're valuable and that the content you're looking at and then the people who are looking at your content are valuable, especially when you start out on the page and you have a particular niche. I think knowing who would inspire you, kind of looking at pages that kind of emulate that style that you're going for. And then I think really interacting with people, I think responding to comments that you get, even leaving comments in other people's posts that have a similar niche as what you're going for can be very helpful. And then there's something where you can have tons of like bot followers and fake followers that follow you. And lots of people used to advertise that a lot, like, hey, pay for this many followers, I'll give you this many followers. And it looked great just to have that big number there, but it can actually negatively affect your account, because if the algorithm sees that you have like 10,000 followers who aren't interacting with your content, it's just going to kind of push your content away. So I think value is just very important.
There's a lot of common sense stuff when it comes to follower count. We used to say 4 quarters is better than 100 pennies on social media. So it's like, I'd rather have 4 really qualified people, like if I'm in insurance, that can actually drive business than 100 just people who like the look of the page or whatever it might be. And there's stuff you can do right on insights. Like if you're a local coffee shop, it's great to have a million followers. That's cool. But if 95% of them are outside of the country or in a different state across the country, it's like, what good does that, is that really going to be driving business? Right. If, you know, it doesn't always hurt, but like Ashley said, if they don't engage with it, if they don't interact with it, it doesn't really do you all that good. So keep in mind, like, you can look at your insights and say, okay, my coffee shop's in North Kingstown, Rhode Island, but all of my followers are from LA or Cal or whatever, scattered all over the place. It's like, okay, well, how can I develop, how can I use what I have now and leverage that locally to get more local followers or whatever it might be? So yeah. Look at the quality of your followers, not always just the number.
One tip that I learned, and I'm interested in hearing your opinion on it, is I heard that if you targeted an ad to another business, so say your coffee shop in North Kingstown, and you target to another coffee shop in North Kingstown that is a frequent competitor of yours, and you target that ad to people
who like that,
who either have been there, checked in there, were shown there, or like it. I've heard that that's a really good way at targeting niche people who actually care about the brand, rather than, like you said, those are the four quarters, then the 100 pennies.
Mm-hmm.
But what are your opinions on that? I feel like that might be a little bit of a guerrilla.
Yeah, so there's some stuff on Google I think you can get in trouble for, right? Like you can't run ads over other people's name. Like, it's kind of black hat.
They're called cloaking laws. So it's pretty much you can't cloak your URL to target. And it originated as first just URL cloaking, because and Honda and Toyota were notorious for doing this to each other. Like, they'll, like, for example, like, you know, Toyota would just have like a random URL, and it's like Toyota, you know, whatever variation there is.
Honda T.
And they will, but when they run their like AdWords campaign, they'll use the URL that's matching the Honda one. So it's like, like, even if someone is searching for like Hondas, it'll come up as Honda, the URL, and it would have like their branding and everything. And then when someone clicks on it, it would just redirect back to Toyota. So
no.
It's like, so it's you know, that's where the cloaking laws kind of started. It's like, hey, that's just like intentional. You know, that's you're not acting, even an accident. That's not a bug.
It's acting in bad faith.
Yeah, that's at that point in time, it's gonna come down, because if they allowed that, that would just come down to who had the bigger budget.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Like, they would just create millions of these, you know, cloaked links, pretty much. So, and then that slowly grew to, you know, it expanded to like, hey, you can't just target certain fan bases. You can't just target, you know, at first you used to, like, let's say you were doing marketing for a bank, you would just be able to, you know, target the base of another bank.
If you're Santander, say, yeah,
like, hey, Bacos, target Newport, all of the people that have Bank of America stuff. And it's because Bank of America's fan base was so big that they could use that audience, right? If you have like a million likes, if you have 2 million, like, you can use that as a lookalike audience. You would be able to do that at first. Now you can't.
I don't know how I feel about all that, man, because in this day and age, like, you know, we've grown up with the access to quick and readily available technology. And now that there's like a gatekeeper on it, which is Meta, and you know, it's like, how much control do we really have?
It's one of the weird things where we all know by using common sense that there's a line somewhere. Yeah. Like, you can't just, you know, spoof someone's URL. That's clearly the wrong, but it's like,
you can, but you'll get caught.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah. So where is that line? And unfortunately, these big companies have been given the responsibility of enforcing those, setting the guidelines. They are the lawmakers when it comes to digital marketing, advertising, and what's right and what's not right.
I did want to make a few comments, just going back to like the,
please,
like the followers and stuff as well. Like, a lot of those agencies that used to like sell the followers, right? Like, give us $50, we'll get you 10,000 followers. A lot of those went out of business too, because I remember when, you know, there were like a plethora of those agencies, like IG started doing purges. So like all these people that had like 200,000 followers, 1 million followers, it's like their accounts went down to like, you know, like 1,000.
Like nothing.
Because like IG purged all of those like bots. And so like those people were exposed pretty fast. Yeah. And they just went,
It's so annoying, man. I hit 1,000 followers recently, and every day it's like 999, and then like 1,007, and it's like 999.
No, but so you know, like, going back to that, like, honestly, it just comes down to strategy for me.
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't even like focus on that number. As long as you're kind of doing the right thing,
right,
you're staying consistent, you're using the right hashtags. Whoever is new to your, you know, to your profile, if they're local, like you know, just send them a DM or something. Like, as long as you're doing the right things, the rest will kind of take care of you know, yeah, itself.
I think that's very well
it's like
said.
Just focus on the strategy. Do your part. It takes time, especially if you're new. You know, like you said, like everyone starts at zero, yep. Right? But it's like, yeah, just do the right things.
Yeah. Consistency.
Yeah. One quick thing you can also do if you're new is like you'll notice if you story something and you use the right hashtags, so like local hashtags, like use like your address, you know, use the right links. You'll notice like sometimes there's new local people like that have viewed your story. And, you know, something quick that you can do is just send those people a message like, hey, by the way, I noticed that, you know, you liked our story or you viewed our story. Like, you know, if you're a new cafe, you can say we'd love for you to, you know, stop by or something. Like, that's how you grow that base starting out.
Interaction.
And those are real people.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, those are real people. But, yeah, just do the right thing. So strategy, like have a strategy in place to follow up with people. Right, to engage with your comments, like reply back to people, say thank you, just have the right strategy in place and the rest will grow by itself.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Exactly. I think something that's been important to know too is if you ever see so many accounts that have big followings, like you mentioned, like it takes time to get there, but I also have personally known some people who maybe they just got lucky, like someone reposted their image on Reddit and it blew up and that's how they mm-hmm. got followers. I actually follow an artist who inspires me a lot, and she's talked about that a few times before, where she's like, someone reposted my drawing on Reddit and it somehow blew up, and that's kind of why I'm at the following I am now, but it doesn't mean that like I'm like better than you, and she's kind of touched on that. So I think that's good to know, is that everyone's path is different and different things can kind of happen 100%. To you along the way.
If you're consistent, you just have to wait your turn.
Yeah,
you know, if you're really consistent, putting out good content, your turn will come, and then something will blow up and it'll happen, and then you start piling on those wins.
Yeah, and don't fall into the mistaken perspective thinking that, hey, just because you like really like you know, one influencer and they have a huge following and all, majority of them really don't have a business plan after themselves. Like, they might be overnight, you know, successes or something where it's like, okay, they might have gotten like huge amounts of followers for just, you know, maybe they did something cool or something engaged, but those aren't necessarily people that are buying their merchandise.
They're not there for the brand.
Yeah, they might just
exactly.
be, you know,
the grass is always
there. Should look on
like,
the
you
surface,
know,
but.
Yeah, like I'm following like Bleacher Report on Instagram just for sports highlights, but I follow them just to catch highlights. You know, it's like I'm not gonna be doing anything else.
Yep.
Right. You know, like if they're selling a jersey or something, like it's not like I'm just buying it.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so it's like, yeah, they might have I don't even know they a few million followers, but it's like you might be doing more business than them because it's like, you know, so yeah, so just don't fall into that.
I think that's
just focus on your strategy. Yeah, just
do the right thing
baby.
That's it.
All right, so I think this would be a good pivoting point.
Yeah
let's all right, cool.
Yeah, let's get into some other tools of the trade or some cool things that we like.
Okay. Right? Let's do it. So we have, I think, yeah, we'll do the tools of the trade. So
what's the other thing that you wanted to go into?
So we have tools of the trade, which everybody brought in. They had a couple of different tools or websites that they wanted to show that could help DIY entrepreneurs and creatives kind of get a leg up and assist in their creative world. Mm-hmm. And then also after that, I know some of us had some content we wanted to review and just some like information we wanted to put out there.
So yeah, we want to make that like a reoccurring you know, segment in the podcast of just like, let's put out a piece of advertising marketing content that we thought was awesome for whatever reason, and so that the vault for that is very low. I mean, that's infinite, so we'll be doing that. I think see if people like it.
Yep. Yeah, we'll put it out there. So
all right,
cool. So who wants to get started? You want to go first?
Sure. Yeah, my first one is just, I love like the Google Chrome plugins. I think Sahil got me started into this years ago, but like there's just so many cool tools out there. So Google Chrome plugin, it's called what is it? GMB Everywhere.
Hold on, let me pull.
Or GMB Everywhere. And so just a quick overview of what it is. It's a plugin that you get on Chrome, and it just changes the way that you see Google Maps. And you can actually get a look behind the curtain and see how well other Google business listings are performing. So, you know, I can use it in my sales process. So like if I'm ever working with a business, I can show them like, okay, here's what your listing's doing right now. And then we can track it over time. But people can use it for competitor research or just to see how well they're doing. So it's kind of cool. So you want to pass that over to me, Seal?
Walk us through some of these, So you might have to mirror it or turn around.
All right.
Because I think you have control of the screen.
No problem. Yeah. Let me just mirror it real quick.
And then it's under Chrome. So the bottom there.
Where are you? I'm thinking that's my computer. Okay. All right, cool. Yeah, so I'll just give you the real quick version of it. But yes, so dentist near me, whatever. If you want to look at, we'll look at the gentle dentist. Okay, you can literally see what their categories are. Okay, so if you're a dentist and you're wondering, hey, well, how should I categorize my business? You can see it all right here. So it's like, these are all the different things that they are categorized as. And maybe this is bad. Like if you're just a tooth whitening, like there are people out there with just teeth whitening services. And if you're getting a lot of shitty leads or getting found for the wrong thing, it's like, well, we don't need all this. We just need the teeth whitening service. And then also, you know, an orthodontist is very, very different than just like, you know, a pediatric dentist, I think. So you want to make sure you're getting hit for the right thing. There's like a paid version of this, but I think that's really kind of the coolest thing.
Yeah, and that's actually so important because like some listings, you know, have seen just significant changes the moment we just correct the category.
Yep.
Like you know, many business owners don't realize like just having the wrong category for your business can be, you know, pushing you in rankings and getting your listing flagged for quality issues because like you just chose the wrong category. It's a simple thing like that can be triggering that. So that is very important.
Totally. And so one of the big things that Google My Business is known for is local SEO, right? And what people don't always know is when you type in dentist near me, it seems obvious, but it's like, it's what's near the person searching it. So you can actually teleport yourself. And so say you want to see how your business ranks for those people in Providence versus South Kingston, you can actually move and change it. So it's like, let's see what someone who's searching at this location sees when they type in dentist near me or just types in my name. Like when someone types in, you know, Namra Consulting Group into their webpage in, you know, North Attleboro, what does that look like versus if they type in Namra Consulting Group in, you know, Seekonk, whatever. So that's another cool feature. Really cool. That's pretty much it. I just think it's a really cool plugin that can definitely help you guys if you're looking to get a little bit more exposure on Google.
Now, can you change your categories within this GMB or is it regular Google My Business?
Nope. Yeah, you got to jump over to the platform to do that. Gotcha. And you know, that's a little bit more in depth.
Right.
But yeah, so I think this is great.
Very cool.
That's my show and tell for the day.
That's awesome. I've been wanting to learn more about Google too, so that's good to know.
Yeah, we could definitely. Yeah, we'll get into it.
Yeah, I love having like tools reviewed like this. Like this is really helpful.
Yeah, I'm a visual learner.
Me too. So,
mm-hmm. Yeah,
seeing it.
That's a good idea.
Do you have one? Who wants to go next? Does anyone else have one?
I guess I can go.
Yeah,
I'll pull it up for you.
Oh, see.
Yeah. Yeah, one, you know, since we were on the top of plugins, a lot of the questions I always get in terms of, you know, on the digital marketing side of things is always in regards to ads, especially like when starting out. So like what might help, like just day to day. There's another plugin called the Facebook Pixel Helper. Ooh. And that one's a little bit more detailed, so we don't, you know, have to go over it. But it's like what that plugin pretty much allows you to do is it helps you troubleshoot like your Facebook pixel. So it pretty much like tells you like what are the different connection points that you have, like you know, are there any breaks in your pixel, is there are there different troubleshooting methods that you need to actually go through to correct any specific ones. So like if you're new to ads and you're kind of doing it yourself, obviously pixel is a very important thing if you're going to be doing e-commerce and retargeting and things like that. Just making sure that you have the pixel installed correctly on your website, that's a great plugin. It pretty much just illuminates green if everything is, you know, if everything checks out and it's installed properly. Otherwise, it will illuminate red and it will actually tell you exactly what you need to fix for it to operate properly.
What's that called again?
Facebook Pixel Helper.
Facebook Pixel Helper. And that's good for
That's a Chrome plugin, and it's
if phenomenal. You're having trouble, if you're working with a company and you're not seeing the return on the ads, something just for accountability sake, maybe it might be good. Or if someone's doing it themselves and they don't like how it's going, it sounds like that's a good tool. Yeah, maybe just check out.
Yeah, it's very simple, and it's as simple as you want it to be, and it's very vast as you want it to be. Like, if you just did not install the Pixel properly, it's going to outline 100 things that you did wrong. Like, let's say your website has, 20 tabs, for example, and you just created one simple aggregate pixel, and you tried to publish that on your website when you technically should have created separate pixels for each of these conversion buttons and connected them so the proper data is getting reported. Like, it'll tell you, like, hey, you only have one. There's no connection point for, like, a purchase or add to cart or save for later or, all these different things. So it just helps you see what you might be doing wrong. And I find that it does a little bit of a better job than Facebook. Yeah. Because, Meta, when you mess up on an ad, they don't give you much context. They just say either, okay, rejected, or okay, not, they'll just rank the quality below average, or, like, there's not much to learn from. Like, they do have their own machine learning going on, which is just their own data collection tools. But it's, if you're really on your own and trying to just, troubleshoot it your own way, that's a great plugin.
Love it. Cool.
Yeah, that's a great tool.
And what was it called again? Facebook.
Pixel Helper.
And that's a Chrome plugin as well.
Yep. Nice. Correct.
Very cool.
All right. We'll pull up Ashley's ad. Cool. I'll pull mine up. So mine is a website that I'd be lying if I said I use it often, but I think it's a really, really cool tool. So this is a website. It's called Strobox. And Strobox gives you a bunch of photos and videos from creatives that upload it themselves. And it shows you how they actually took the picture or they shot the video. So let's pick on the first photo, for example. And so if you see, it comes up with a diagram here. It shows you the flash that they used, what type of reflector they used, and where they put the camera and how they lit the situation. If you scroll down, it actually shows you, we're shooting at 1/60th, at f/5.6, at ISO 400.
And it gives you the focal length. That's really cool.
Yep. Focal length shows the camera. Specifically, like the model of light used, it goes into really, really cool detail, and you can click on these for everything. Some are obviously a lot more intricate.
And now, can you sort these by camera? So, say, that's cool.
So, that's a good question. Can you?
That's like actually camera. Really awesome.
If you could just look at all the GH5s or Sony A, whatever.
So, I'll need to play with it a little bit more, but I know you can sort it by category and what type of light, but by camera, I don't know. You'll have to look a little more.
Oh, top right there. By latest.
Latest. Oh. Come on. God,
nope.
But still, so this is really useful. Just in, even if you're somebody who's not into, doing this professionally, if you just want to start stepping up your lighting and your videos for your branding or any, your social media, this is a super helpful tool for that. And then they also have a video tab, which isn't as extensive, but they do have some good behind-the-scenes stuff of, certain shoots. How they lit it, what types of stuff they used. So basically the same thing just on the video side. So this is a really cool tool just to kind of mess around with and spend some time just learning and kind of educating yourself.
That's awesome.
All right. So I figured that would be a good pivot point onto our reviews, section. So I figured since lighting is kind of like my topic of the day, I figured I would just reinforce it a little bit more by running through a quick little lighting crash course. So me and Russ spent the morning just doing some pictures and creating some lighting setups so that we could kind of show our audience what basic lighting looks like. So this is really helpful for anybody, if you're a DIY creator, entrepreneur, anything like that. I think you're going to find this interesting. So I'm going to try to keep this under 5 minutes. It's really quick. There's not a whole lot of content, but it is really basic stuff that is fundamental for a good lighting setup. You're going to learn basic techniques, terms, and equipment. So like I said, this is going to be definitely for DIY entrepreneurs, whether you're a real estate agent, you're a business owner, or you're just somebody who's just starting your business looking to create content, or if you're doing it for clients as well. So today we're going to run through some lighting equipment and the basic setup that we're going to do for this type of shoot. We're going to describe and talk to you about what three-point lighting setup is, and then after that we're going to just talk a little bit about what's to come in some future episodes. So section one, we're going to go over and this seems a little intimidating, but there's only two sections. I promise it's not long. So we're going to talk about equipment and setup. So we're going to go over the basic lighting equipment, placement, strengths, all those different types of things. So in this demo, Russ and I used four different types of main equipment. First was a panel light. So that's basically just, some LED lights put on a panel. They can either be handheld or a little bit bigger. A mono light, which, they're a little bit better than the panel lights, depending on what you're looking to use, because they do have a more secure rail system. So you can put things like diffusers, softboxes, et cetera, on it more universally. And then, like I said, softboxes there. That kind of just helps to soften the light going across your subject. So we'll talk about that a little bit more, and a reflector too. So we'll get into how you use these things in a second. But first, I want to talk about what each piece of equipment is doing what. So there's three main lights that we're going to be talking about today. It is the key light, the fill light, and the backlight. And so for our setup, we used a monolight with a softbox at 100% strength for the key light. For the fill, we used a monolight with a grid and barn doors at about 50%. And then in this situation, if it's like a tight scene or if you don't have a third light, you could always use a reflector to reflect that key light into the fill. So I'll explain a little bit more kind of what that means when we get there. And then also a backlight too. So that'll help you kind of pull out the background of your subject. We used a panel light at 20% for that. So this is the second section. So it's basically going to tell you exactly how we lit this, and it's going to show you examples of what each light looks like on the face versus other lights. So this is pretty much what the setup looked like. We had some extra lights too. We lit both sides, but this is the best basic lighting setup you can get with three lights. Like I said, you get your fill, your key, and your backlight. So we'll talk about what each of those are now. So we got our beautiful model Russ here, and he's wiping the crust out of his eyes. It was nice and early 7 a.m. this morning when he decided to help me with this. So shout out to Russ. So this picture is just the key light. So the key light is going to be your main light in your scene. It's going to be the brightest light in your scene. So you can have three positions that you could put this in. This one is coming from the side. So when when the key light's coming from the side, it's going to split the light on the face. So if you look on the left side of Russ's face, it's going to be darker. And on the right side of his face, it's going to be lighter because the light is coming from the right side of his face. You could also put it in front of the face, which kind of flattens the subject a little bit more, evenly lighting the entire subject. And you could also put it from above, which would spread the light out from top to bottom. So these are all just used for different looks. None of them are right or wrong. It's all creative taste. So as you can see, this is a photo without the key light, and this is with the key light.
That one on the left is great. Oh, the nightmare fuel.
Yeah, literally.
Halloween trailer.
So you could just use the key light. Like, you could stop there, and it looks okay, but we could do better. So we're going to go on to the fill light. So the fill light, you can see from before and after. Look on the left, on the right picture, you can see on the left side of his face, it's very dark. And then now it's bright a little bit more. So the fill light just kind of fills in those shadows, and it helps sculpt the face a little bit more. Again, this is all creative preference, but the fill light is really where you're going to get that creative touch from, at least lighting your subject. So again, a little bit less of a distinctive difference, but if you see on the left side, that's just the key light, so without the fill light. Left side of his face, a lot of shadows. On the right side, nice and evenly lit. And then now we're going to move into the rim light. So the rim light is basically going to create depth from the subject and pull them out from the background a little bit. So you could either use, for this instance, a backlight, you could either use a rim light or hair light, depending on the situation. But we used a rim light, so we're going to just talk about that today. So as you can see, the rim light without, and then the rim light with the rim light. So you can see on his cheeks, it kind of defines his facial structure and his jawline a little bit more there. So that pretty much wraps up the three-point lighting system. So as you can see, we go from the left side, which is without any lighting, all just natural lighting from the windows, and then to full lighting with the background lit, lights on, and we got a smiling Russ. So that pretty much covers everything. That's A to Z of how to light a quick crash course setup. So you learned about the key light, fill light, backlight, hair light and the rim light. So if you can understand those basic concepts, you'll be able to light your setting really, really well. So thank you, everybody.
I just brought a YouTube video. Freaking A, dude. All right.
So yeah, so then these are just some other things we can talk about in the future. There's so many other avenues to talk about with lighting, but there's just a million and million of things to do. So if you guys are watching this as a clip on social media, make sure you check out the Namra podcast. We're live every Monday at 7 p.m. New episode every week, baby.
Woo!
So, all right, that is my monologue. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk.
Very well done, dude. That was awesome. I didn't know that was coming.
Thanks, no, me guys. Either. I'm
That was perfect.